that's
Camera two.
That's fine. Hi, I'm Jean Flanagan. This is Dead Air Live, and welcome. And our show tonight is U.S. Paralympic sled hockey, and we're going to introduce you to some sled hockey and some sled hockey players, and let you find out what this sport is all about. So we're going to start over here, and Carlo plays the Boston Blades. They all play on the Boston Blades.
Yes, that's correct.
And Dale is one of the organizers for the Chowder Cup. We're going to watch a lot of the Chowder Cup tonight. We're going to watch a lot of sled hockey and do some talking about it. And Glenn is also, and Kip, and that's everybody that's on. So somebody tell me about sled hockey. What's sled hockey all about? When was it started?
Sled hockey is ice hockey for people with disabilities, physical disabilities. And what you'll find if after watching some of the clips and whatnot, is that it's the same game. Instead of putting our skates on our feet, we actually sit in our sleds. It's full equipment, full contact, it's all the same rules. And the name of the game is to go out and put the puck in the net more times than the other team does.
There you go. That sounds good.
For a lot of the guys that we all play with, we were all hockey players when we were able-bodied. And I had cancer. These fellows had spinal cord injury. They amputated my leg in 93, and I hadn't played hockey for about 15 years. And the first time I got on a sled, smelled the cold of the ice, mm-hmm. chased somebody into a corner and checked them and had them hit the boards, I said, oh, this is hockey, this is my game.
You're back there.
I'm back.
That's good.
And that's why all these guys are playing it, because it is hockey. It's full contact. It's rough and tumble.
So is sled hockey big in the same places in the country that it's big and that hockey's big?
Sled hockey's starting to grow. It has taken off slowly. It's been played over in Europe since the mid-60s. Mm-hmm. It came to Canada probably 25 years ago, and I'm told that there are 100 teams up in Canada.
I've heard 100, 200, 300 Canadians. You never know.
Canadians. It made its way to the United States back in 1989, and in 93 it was introduced into the Boston area, and we really didn't get going until probably the spring and fall of 94
right.
is
okay.
when we really started to get going. And it's like everything else, it's getting the ice time, and we've been very fortunate that Commissioner Balfour has kindly donated ice time to us, so that's a big help.
That's great.
Because it keeps the cost of running the program down.
Mm-hmm.
We don't charge anybody to come and skate, and we supply the equipment if they don't have their own equipment.
So where do the Blades practice?
I'd like to make one other point.
Go ahead.
It's actually open to anybody that wants to play. We don't try to just keep exclusive to people with disabilities. When you go to Canada, you see a lot of able-bodied people playing, and it really exposes the game to a lot more people. A lot more people get involved, and it's really good if we could get more folks to show up, because once you get used to maneuvering the sled, the able-bodied person will be able to maneuver the sled better than myself, who I'm paralyzed from the waist down, and I don't have the hip movement like an able-bodied person would, or a person with, like Joe Howard, for instance. He's a double amputee, and his stumps still have the muscles work, and he can maneuver the sled very well. And he's probably actually better than an able-bodied person because his sled is so much shorter because of his short stumps.
Mm-hmm.
And he's really something to watch.
We have
absolutely jealous.
we have some pictures of the Boston Blades playing. So we'll see. We'll see Joe and Kip and I'm not sure how many of you were out on the ice in the little clips that I have. Where do the Boston Blades practice?
We practice at the Divine Arena in Dorchester on Morrissey Boulevard.
Oh, okay.
We started in September at every Wednesday night at 9 o'clock. And we practice from 9 to 11
uh-huh.
every Wednesday night
every
from
Wednesday night.
About the early part of September to the end of March or early April.
So this basically the same season as league hockey?
Positively, sure.
Yeah.
And anybody's welcome to come down. As Glenn said, that was one of the nice things. Everybody talks about inclusion.
Right.
And this is the only sport that I'm aware of where you can have able-bodied, you can have paraplegics, you can have quadriplegics, you can have amputees, have CP athletes all skating, all playing the same game on the same plane.
Excellent.
Yeah. That's true inclusion.
That's great. Well, we're going to go and we're going to watch the tape now, and we're going to leave our mics open so you guys can talk about what you're looking at. So this is 2 weeks ago in Marlboro was the Chowder Cup, and Dale, I guess you organized the whole thing.
Well, the Chowder Cup is actually an able-bodied tournament, and 4 years ago, George Powell, who runs the Chowder Cup, asked us to come and put on an exhibition, and then it has just grown from there. We went from an exhibition of two teams to this year we had 10 teams.
Yeah, from all over the country.
All over the country.
It was
we had
really
one
amazing.
Team from Canada. We had two junior teams, and we had eight adult teams.
Yeah.
So it was a great time. And part of the fun of running a tournament or being in a tournament is that you get to see people that you only see once or twice a year at tournaments. And we all have friends in Canada, in Colorado, in Texas, all over the place.
Yeah. So let's watch some Paralympic sled hockey.
Off the ice or three?
3 inches.
3 inches off the ice.
In order for a puck. 10 meters to 9.5 centimeters.
Yeah, whatever the puck is standing on edge has to be able to travel.
Oh, so,
the
okay.
And if the sled has to be, at a minimum, has to be 3 times longer than the skate blade. So if you have skate, you know, if the skate blade is 10 inches long, the sled at a minimum has to be 30 inches.
Oh, okay.
That becomes important when you're dealing with amputees who obviously have smaller sleds, so therefore they want smaller blades to be able to get the maximum.
Right.
Some of the fellows were even using children's skate blades at one point, weren't they? Kept to make it shorter.
Just to shorten the sled.
Now, what kind is it? Is it a different blade? Is it a skate blade?
It's a regular skate blade.
It is a skate blade.
Originally, when we started back in 94, they used to take the boot of the skate and they would pop the rivets off, and then they'd mount the plastic skate holder with the blade in it. They're now buying replacement blades that you can buy to put into skate, right, and they're mounting them into pieces of can line or holding them onto pieces of angle line. Most of these sleds are made out of aluminum to cut down the weight.
Yeah. And then the front isn't a runner or anything. It's just a piece of metal.
They call it a skid, just to keep it from tipping down and touching the ice. Mm-hmm. And you'll notice that some of the fellas are able to keep that runner off the ice, which cuts down on the friction. I think Carlo has a piece of plastic on the bottom of his so that he can glide along the ice without. With as few, a little resistance as possible. There's been a great change in the sticks too. Back in 94, when you bought a sled, you used to get two sticks. And what they do is take a hockey stick, cut it in half, and put the picks on the stick. So you'd have one stick with a blade, one stick without a blade. The problem with that was that the lie of the blade, the angle of the blade to the stick, because you're only 3 inches off the ice or 4 or 5 inches off the ice, was too high. So different fellas around the world started to make their own sticks. And now I guess there are a couple of manufacturers that are making sticks with a lower lie to the blade. As you can see, these different sticks that we're using here. The picks have also changed. Originally, the picks were made out of bandsaw blades, but the bandsaw blades became very hard to cut and very hard to drill. So now there are different styles of picks that are being made by machine shops all around the country and all around the world. And they're trying different shapes to the picks. Mm-hmm. To try and get more speed out of it instead of biting into the ice without damaging the ice.
Damaging the ice, yeah. You see a ref, at some point, a ref has to repair the ice just like they do in hockey.
Sure.
Plus the picks can only protrude a certain amount, I think it's only going.
Is that even more than that? Maybe a 16.
Mm-hmm. So that you won't injure someone else. You can get cut by them, but very seldom happens, really, depending on the equipment you wear too.
Picks don't damage the ice any more than a figure skater.
Right. Right. Figure skaters definitely do damage on the ice. Yep. So you have full shoulder padding?
Shoulder pads, elbow pads, helmet pads, gloves, neck pad.
Neck pad.
Especially on the neck pad. Shin pads.
It'll never happen to me.
The sleds that you're looking at cost anywhere from $500 to $1,000.
Okay.
Yeah, so the cost of the equipment is substantial.
Yeah.
A pair of sticks can cost, with the picks on them, anywhere from $30 to $80.
Yeah.
For a pair of sticks, depending on the manufacturer.
Well, some incidents are unavoidable. It's just the mechanics of the motion is just such that you can't get out of the way out of it.
Right.
Accidents do occur.
Yeah.
And also, some folks' disabilities don't allow them to turn as well.
Mm-hmm.
I've never played motor hockey, so I get called for penalties that I did not think was a penalty.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I did admit to it. I was trying to take him out of the play, so I checked him.
We're going to change that next year for
yeah.
All right, this is Boston in Colorado.
Boston, Colorado.
This is the very end of this is the very end of their game.
What a fun. What a fun. Actually, is this Boston or New England?
I was complaining out on the ice trying to tell you how to turn the calm down. I had just turned 40
years old
to let them know they got to respect their elders. And when one of the double amputees showed in, you know, he told me, how do you like that for a 60-year-old? So, it's a lot of fun.
So there's a lot of ages covered.
I couldn't tell you. I guess there was a fight in one time at a game up in Canada. It was very short-lived. You never see that. Well, it's competitive, without a doubt. Because you run home.
But fewer penalties. Maybe just.
Well, not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
This is no check. It's fine. So a lot of times for the beginning, they usually call a lot of penalties. If you take a look at the game you win against Canada, you will call for a lot of penalties. But then the same refs happen to ref the game later after they were informed and realized that certain incidents that are occur, let it go. So therefore,
if they normally would have called against us, they didn't call against Chicago and Canada because they realized that this is a way to play.
Oh, okay. So trying to train the refs is part of it.
It's almost like they should be in service.
Yeah, I believe that.
One thing we missed on the tape was they had someone out there pushing one of the individuals that really couldn't move their slow down.
And his handles on the back there.
Yeah. We'll see that more in the junior. When we watch the juniors play, there's a couple of juniors on the ice a lot.
The hottest part of the game is getting him out of the sled.
Well, thanks for commenting on that. It was good to watch, and I hope you guys watched it and started to actually see the hockey part of the game, which I think is what made it so exciting. I saw it the first time this winter. I know a lot of the women on the U.S. hockey team, and they played an exhibition game at BU, and you guys came out and did 10 minutes during one of their periods, during one of their breaks, and it was just. It was outrageous. It was great fun to watch. And that was the U.S. team that was playing.
I believe that was our first training camp after the team was selected.
That's right.
Was it?
Yes.
Yeah, we ran a training camp. We've run three training camps for the U.S. team here in Boston. And that was in October that we ran the training camp. It was the first training camp, you're right, for the 2002 Paralympic team.
And for the trip to Canada was canceled after September 11th.
Right.
So what I want to do now is we're gonna watch a little bit. I've got 5 minutes of the juniors playing hockey, and it's as painful as watching any Mighty Mites playing hockey. But just to show how difficult the game is, because it's a lot harder than watching all these well-trained adults running around and.
Well, for us, it's very rewarding because one of the junior teams is the Massachusetts Hospital School. And all of us have worked with that team at one point or another.
Mm-hmm.
We helped them get established. And Trish Devine, who is the coach for the Mass Hospital team, played for the women's hockey team before they were a Paralympic team.
Uh-huh.
So Trish has played all over the world, and she's a great hockey player. She usually plays on a men's team because she can't find a women's team to play on.
Right.
But they got tired of me lugging sleds in and telling them about sled hockey, so they finally formed one. And I know Kip's been down and Carlo's been down, and I think, Glenn, you've been down and worked out with the kids and showed the kids what they could do with a sled.
That's great.
So it's rewarding for us to see the kids out there playing.
Yeah.
They're the future of the program, so.
That's how you make it grow.
2010, 2000.
Well, the program for the U.S. Representation, sled hockey, right.
Right.
And to add a little bit to that is that I was on the 1998 team along with Kip and Joe Howard, who's not here, as well as another kid, Ed Clark, that was from Southern New Hampshire. But to give you an idea, when we had to make the selection for that particular team, we only had roughly about 25 players to pick from, if that. Not even that.
We had probably 30, 35 people show up, but only really 15 to 20.
Were there.
Had the possibility of even
Right.
As opposed to when we made the selection process in Buffalo for the 2002 team.
Yep.
It had pretty much doubled in length, doubled, but as far as kids that were on the bubble, so to speak, there was at least 30 to pick from,
right,
or 35 to pick
yep.
from. So, and looking at 2006, as you see some of the games that are on the screen here, you'll see that there's going to be even more. Even if people aren't going to be trying out for 2006, you will actually see that there are more juniors coming up that are only getting better.
Right.
Believe in the adults, the level of play from 98 to 2002.
No comparison.
It's unbelievable.
It's fabulous. It's fabulous.
That's great. That's great. Well, we're going to show the juniors now, and then when we come back, I'm going to get in a roller sled, and we'll see how well I do getting around on the floor over here. And so let's watch the juniors play and follow how hard they have to work.
Kids are anywhere from age 8 up to age 17. And again, you have girls mixed in with the boys. And that's the other thing when you talk inclusion. There's not a lot of sports that girls can get on the ice and compete on an equal level with boys. But sled hockey is one of those sports. And you'll see a lot more pushers in the juniors than you will in the adults. Mm-hmm. Most tournaments don't allow adults to have a pusher. We allowed Buffalo to bring an adult that skates with them, and our tournament, we want to be a fun tournament, so we just allow just about anybody to come in and skate and have fun. And that's the whole idea. We want people out there to be active and to have fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, it was interesting to watch. Just this is the warm up, and they're shooting on goalie. It's the same warm up sets that you see in hockey.
Yeah. It's basically everything is the exact same. The stretching drills, the line drills, the dribbling the drills, the passing drills. Whatever you can do with an able-bodied skater, you can do with a skater in a sled.
Dribbling
drills, yes.
Playing basketball here now?
Exactly.
Oh, okay.
Stick handling drill.
The only difference I see is that, other than we're sitting down, in the Paralympics we play 3 15-minute stop time periods instead of 3 20-minute stop time periods.
Mm-hmm.
It's a no-touch icing, which means as soon as the puck crosses the goal line, the refs will blow the whistle. And
okay. And
we have one more penalty other than able-bodied hockey, and that's T-barring. You can't hit the side of somebody's sled with the front of yours.
Okay.
Other than that, there's no other. It's the same game.
Same game.
And a 90-degree angle.
Yeah. Tripping's really hard to call on a sled hockey, but
it's been done.
It's been done.
It has been done. That's
right.
Yeah. There was some slashing called. I think there were a couple of, with the kids, they were still trying to teach the kids some of that.
Usually you see a lot of interference, a lot of roughing, and hitting from behind, and the T-barring.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the
elbows.
Primary. Not so much elbow, but high stick.
They should
They'll be they'll blow the whistle for a lot of high sticking.
What I enjoy when I see the kids is that for a family that has a child with a disability, especially if there are siblings, it is easy for a family to take little Johnny to Little League and Mary to ballet and Tommy to soccer and little Timmy in the wheelchair. He has to tag along and either watch his siblings or he sits home in front of a TV or playing Nintendo. There are very few programs out there for children with disabilities to become active.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't get children active when they're young, by the time they get to be 13, 14 years old, if all they've ever done is sit in front of a TV or a computer, they don't want to get out there and be active.
Too late.
And as they get to be adults and they become more and more sedentary, it gets harder and harder. And it's the same thing applies with people with disabilities as the able body. The more active you are, the happier you are, the healthier you are, the more productive you are. Same thing with people with disabilities. And actually, we like to say this ability, not disability.
Who are we having this game?
Massachusetts Hospital School, I think, against Niagara? Buffalo?
Yeah, Buffalo.
But this program, like any other program, has its fundraising is always the necessary evil.
Yeah.
And it's a lot of work. And like,
I'd be one of those, just like flip over on this.
But that's, you'll be better by the second day. And you'll improve all the time.
And for these kids, a lot of these kids are the only child in their school in a wheelchair. So you bring them into a program and they don't have any peers. You bring into a program like this and there's 15 or 20 kids in wheelchairs and their world expands. Then you take them to a tournament and
there's hundreds.
Right?
There's
so their world gets bigger and bigger and bigger. And you get to see kids who never popped a wheelie in a wheelchair see other kids their age popping wheelies. So they'll start trying it.
Yep.
Changes the quality of life.
That's right. Exactly.
And the other thing that I want to add, kind of add to what he's saying, I remember one time we happened to go to a public skating where one of the local gyms, athletic directors or gym teachers had decided to bring a fifth grade class. And there was one kid that was in a wheelchair that was there, but we brought a bunch of sleds and let the kids that were, I want to use the word able body, I really don't like the word, but get into the sled and try it. Nobody really wanted the skate. They wanted all to be in the sled.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the joy that I got out of it was the fact that I ended up seeing the kid that was limited to the sled.
Right.
Starting to have fun with the kids that normally he was not able to sit on the side of the ice and watch.
Right.
His mother said it was the first time that his classmates had interacted with him because he knew how to maneuver the sled. They'd come up and they'd say, Chris, how do you do this? How do you stop? Right. How do you turn?
They had to learn from him.
Exactly.
Right. Right.
And that's a big equalizing factor. Okay, I guess I'm ready.
I'll go on. Get in the sled.
I will say one thing in your defense before you get in. It's going to be a lot harder to do it with those wheels than it would be on the ice.
Well, that's good to hear.
Okay. So if you're good, that means you got to come to practice.
That, and Glenn thought it was easier on the basketball court.
Yeah. It was different, without a doubt.
We'll try not to snicker.
Oh, go ahead.
Snicker
all you want.
You're going to need these. That thing's set just the right height for you.
The Mass Hospital School has.
After you get done there, can we flip it over and show folks the wheels where the blades would be?
And we got a blade sled here, too.
Yeah.
And then the USA flags all over it.
The picks on the sticks and whatnot.
Oh, I'm not supposed to go backwards.
No, you can go backwards. You can go backwards. Yeah.
If they get the puck, you got to chase them backwards.
You're thinking you're rowing the boat there, yeah.
That's why it's a great cross trainer for you.
Turning's not.
You're doing it right, though. You just turn, lean back and then turn the shoulder.
I'm not ready to pop a wheelie.
Well, that's going to
be. You're not going to tip over.
It's got a wheelie bar in there. Yeah. You're not going to be able to, so I wouldn't worry about it.
Okay.
Massachusetts Hospital School has five of these sleds with the wheels so that in the wintertime they play sled hockey indoors in the gymnasium.
So for 15 minutes summertime. I get to do this. Yeah.
We happen to go
real
to
fast.
That's why we're always in sliding seats.
We did a demo over in Springfield for the Springfield Falcons, and one of the assistant coaches got on the sled. And went up and down the ice and came back and realized that it was a great cardiovascular workout. And he had said that, you know, it'd be a great thing for me to put somebody in here that just had surgery on his leg that really can't get on the sled, that can't get on the skates. And supposedly he had done that to a gentleman that had a surgery on his legs and did it. The kid was skating for a while. And when he got back on the ice and was shooting, his slap shot and wrist shot were about 18 miles an hour faster.
Wow.
That's amazing.
Because he did so much upper body work.
Oh, yeah, just muscles that he probably wasn't normally working out that he's really working out.
Okay, now here's the other thing. I don't have to just drive myself around on this sled. I got to be able to turn the stick over and hit the puck. And I was watching that.
All you do is slide your hand down the shaft.
Slide it down the shaft.
And then control the puck. And
control it. And it gets stuck under my sled. I can just see it now.
I guess that's the biggest difference between sled hockey and able-bodied hockey is that you have two sticks and you shoot left-handed or right-handed.
I can do that. I when I pick up a hockey stick, I never know which side I should shoot from. I could deal with. But I don't know.
See, I'm strictly right-handed. From growing up playing able-bodied hockey, I was right-handed.
That's all you do.
Anytime it ends up on my left hand, I put it over to my right.
I watched one of the juniors. He was getting lots of leverage this way, so he was hitting people with his hand on the stick.
They actually have increased the length of the sticks.
The blade?
The sticks themselves.
Mm-hmm.
The whole sticks themselves. And I think we have a theory about the reason why they're doing it. It was pretty much voted in by the Sweden and Norwegian team. So this way you wouldn't have to change your hands as much. You'd be holding the stick further down and you'd still have the leverage to pull and push, so you could just be going from back to forth.
Right, so you're just doing this instead of having to.
Because you'd have a longer stick in the middle. It's almost like cross-country skiing, anybody that's ever tried it. It's the same motion as far as your upper body's concerned, other than you're just sitting down.
Sure.
Right.
Sure, that makes sense. Well, this is fun. Well, let's take a close look at these sleds.
This is the most dangerous part now, though, see?
Yeah. It is in rowing, too.
getting out. Yep.
Standing in the water, putting the boat in the dock. Okay. So this has the whole handle on the back, actually.
Yep. That's so somebody can push you around.
Now, if you'd like, you can show what Kip's sled looks like with the ice skates on the bottom. I don't know if Kip can make it around there. Why don't you show me?
Pick it up.
Yeah, go ahead. Pick that up and throw that right up on the table.
Just gotta pop those skate blades off.
Oh, there they are, the skate blades themselves.
And that's the same blade that if you had a pair of ice skates and you had to have the blades changed, and I understand high school hockey players, professional hockey players, on a regular basis, we'll go through one or two sets of blades a year.
Yeah, they do. They get.
I actually have another set of blades for that, and actually they're here. They're in the bag.
So it's got the same hollow. It's got the same hollow grind on it.
They're sharpened the same way.
Pop those off.
Nice little hockey skate.
Have them sharpened and slap them right back in there.
Now you were telling me there's a difference between this sled isn't a legal international sled.
That's
because
correct.
It's got square.
Right.
It's used in Canada, it's used here in the United States, but in international play, in competition, the rules say that the tubing has to be round, the front of the sled has to be round, and so they don't allow the square tubing. The fellow that makes that sled, and we call that a program sled, where Kip's sled is what we call a high-tech sled.
Mm-hmm. More of a custom sled.
Well, a custom sled.
That's right. But the fellow that makes that sled uses square tubing because a square tubing is stronger than round tubing. So he's able to make that sled lighter and as strong as using round tubing.
Let me put these
just
back
to give
on.
You a sense on this sled. And this sled was built custom for me to my specifications and my measurements.
Mm-hmm.
The bucket came from Japan, the skate blades came from Sweden, and this frame was made right here in Somerville by Newhall's Wheels. And there's four bolts to go through the bucket, the frame, and blades to hold it all together.
Hold it all together. It's pretty simple.
Mm-hmm. What did you wind up paying for everything, buying it piecemeal and putting it together?
I was paid for it, yeah.
Quite a bit. all said and done, this thing's would be close to probably anywhere from $1,500 to $2,000.
That's about right.
Yeah, that's a lot of money.
As opposed to the sled that you were just in, was $200. And then the wheel kit was $145, and that push handle was $15. So that's why we call it a program sled. For programs to spend $1,500 on sleds,
it's better to do the $200.
Mm-hmm. Rowing has the same kinds of
another change
expenses.
That has come about that we've learned through Broken Foots is if you look at the little cow catcher on the front, that's something that since 1998 a lot of the guys are starting to put on it because inevitably accidents do occur and you do end up hitting head on, and I know Kip's broken my foot a couple times just the way we're going into it. So I says we got to get cow catchers on these things, or we're going to be breaking our feet all the time.
Right. So and just to protect.
You can see it's taking a beating.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a pretty new sled too.
Yeah. This frame was
probably 8 months, 9 months old.
Not even.
Really.
I broke this out in late January, early February.
There you go.
So.
Okay. Well, let's take a quick peek at your medal, and we're going to talk about the Paralympics. And so I understand you guys did a lot better this year than you did 4 years ago, huh?
Worst to first.
come on, you don't give yourself some credit for that.
In 98, you were ranked fifth, and you came sixth.
We were ranked sixth, finished sixth.
Oh, do we?
Out of 16.
Yep. 2000 for the World Championships. Actually, in 98, it was seven teams. In 2000 for the World Championships, we were at sixth out of six teams. And that's where we were ranked and finished. And we went into Salt Lake City this past year, 2002 in March, for the Paralympics as a sixth-seeded team. And really, the only reason we were there is because we were the host country. The fifth-seeded team was to be determined. They had a playoff over in Europe between Great Britain, Estonia, and Germany to determine who the fifth-seeded team would be. And they were ranked higher than we were. But we went in and surprised everybody.
Including
and,
yourselves, I take it.
No, we believed that we could win.
Oh, good.
We just, great. We didn't know. We knew we had improved. We didn't know how much the other teams had improved.
Yeah.
And we were kind of in hiding for 2 years, so nobody knew what was going on with the U.S. team. And that was part of our strategy. And we went in. We dominated.
Well, the only thing that would have happened is had 9/11 had not occurred, the U.S. team would have had a tournament up in Montreal, which and then they would have seen actually what we had.
Oh, okay.
But because of 9/11, Montreal tournament was canceled. Nobody was flying. So in a way, it was a blessing in the sense that we didn't show our cards.
Right.
And when we show, but Kip and Joe show their cards that were on the team. And then when they got to Salt Lake, as much as we knew what we had, they didn't know what we had.
Right.
And
oh, okay.
I happened to show up just as the Canadian game was going on, starting up, and I've told Kip when they scored the second goal, I got finger marks on the railing right there because I knew at this point, okay, we got it. It's going to happen.
Great. So we're going to watch the little promo tape that you brought about the Paralympics.
Okay.
And
if it's the one that the USSC did, what you'll see is it shows the alpine and Nordic skiing as well as sled hockey, give you a flavor of what the events are and some of the different disabilities. You'll see people missing a leg, an arm, blind athletes, as well as the people that are in wheelchairs.
Mm-hmm.
All competing for gold, silver, and bronze.
Okay, let's look a little bit at the intro to the sled hockey.
For granted, so I learned from my mistakes. You
Welcome back. And we're here talking about sled hockey. So that was a little intro to you to the Paralympics. And so there's Nordic skiing, downhill skiing, and sled hockey are the three events. And so they break down. So we've been talking about sled hockey. So there you go, Kip. It's your turn. What was it like?
Incredible. Number one, to be there on your home soil with your family and friends there, people that have supported you over the years to help you get there. That was an amazing experience. Number one, let them see what you can accomplish, and then to have them just experience the thrill of all the games, not just the sled hockey games, but the skiing events and opening and closing ceremonies and just everything else that's happening around Salt Lake City. But for us to come in there and be the sixth-seeded team and you know, come out of there with a gold medal was truly special and really an honor to represent the country the way we did.
Mm-hmm. Undefeated, correct?
Yes. We went through the round robin undefeated with 22 goals for and 3 against, and then went into the gold medal game against Norway, who was the reigning gold medal champs. And in front of a sold-out crowd, it was 8,300 with tickets, and they figure another 1,000 people came through without tickets, whether it was volunteers, staff members, or whatnot.
Right.
And standing room only, and to have it end at the end of regulation, still be 3-3 tie, go into a 10-minute overtime, still 3-3, and then a 5-man shootout, and the U.S. comes out on top, and to look up at the scoreboard and see USA 4, Norway 3, and USA gold medal winners.
Kip's being modest because Kip scored the winning goal in that 5-man shootout.
And we're about to watch that. And then, you know, I have to tell you that when I was in rowing, listening to the national anthem is pretty wild.
Watching them raise the flag, and, you know, there wasn't anybody on the team, including the coaches, that didn't have a dry eye. I mean, it was special.
I think the whole place, I was there watching it, but the whole place was the energy that was in there was amazing. It felt like the whole building had just created its own life, you know?
Yeah.
It's still really hard to believe. I mean, the medal sits on my bureau just the way it is right here, and I'll wake up in the middle of the night and look over and I was like, I've got a gold medal. I want a gold medal.
I thought you slept with that, though.
It's incredible.
You know what I find amazing is their accomplishment of going in ranked number 6, not expected to be in the medal round at all, and coming out undefeated and winning the gold medal rivals the 1980 Dream Team that everybody talks about all the time. Yet the amount of coverage that this country gave to the Paralympics was almost nil. The gold medal game in Canada has been played, I think, 8 times already. It was played 3 times the first week after the Paralympics.
Right.
And Canada wasn't even in the gold medal round.
So we have to teach.
Well, most of the coverage that we actually have that we have in our personal libraries usually come from friends of ours that were in Canada whose families recorded it.
Yeah.
Because like Dale said, I mean, they covered the whole games, and it gives you an idea of the differences of where we need to educate to bring people up. And I don't mean that in a condescending manner. I mean it in a sense that Canada's been doing this for a lot longer than we have.
Right.
Okay.
Well, Canada covers sports better.
Well,
right. Than
but
the
Canada's
US.
All Canada's, and I not don't want to dwell on this other than more, but they have always been inclusive.
Right.
Okay. And I don't want to bring up the fact of the marathon when you had those Canadian kids that pushed in the marathon in a chair. Okay. A lot of the guys that are pushing in chairs, you say, you know what, bring them on.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing wrong with that. They shouldn't be limited.
Right.
If you want to get in it, look at it as a sport, period.
Right.
Don't look at it as whether it's disabled, abled, or whatever. Because you can put Muffy against Peekaboo Streeps in a downhill monoski, and Peekaboo will be lucky if she gets 15, 20 feet.
Right.
Okay. So I'm looking at it as a sport, as just the sport itself.
Yeah.
If they do it that way, they'll realize that there's a lot of opportunities out there for able bodies as well as disabled.
Right.
Because it's a lot of fun.
Good. Well, we're going to watch the tape that you brought in, Kip, of the end of the gold medal game and you doing the shootout. So let's go to that tape.
Actually, what you'll see right at the beginning is a really good hit that Joe Howard takes. And it's key.
That should be on the thrill of victory.
What's key about it is the guy that hit Joe was one of the top scorers for Norway, and it was right towards the end of the overtime period. Because he was in the penalty box, he couldn't participate in the shootout.
Okay. And that's important.
So that was
important piece of information.
Right.
And okay. Joe, you know, to his credit, kept his cool and didn't follow him into the penalty box and was able to, you know, get us going in the shootout.
Great.
That was never brought out on A&E that was a penalty. It looked like a penalty to me, but it was never brought out.
No, it was.
I think Joe asked him if that is that all you got?
Yeah, I was right there.
Okay.
I know exactly.
Okay, let's roll it to the tape.
But you're going to see a little more in this if, in fact, it shows more. Of the
Welcome back. We might as well get right to it. It's out to the E Center now for the conclusion of the gold medal sledge hockey game. Here's Ian and Brent.
The United States and Norway will go to a shootout to determine the gold medal in the overtime period. The United States, a golden opportunity. Jack Sanders took a feed in front from Sylvester Fliss. Couldn't quite handle the pass and get the shot away. And then a huge hit on Joe Howard.
Joe Howard cut in the middle. He gets a lot of speed. Had the lane. Rovolstad comes across and hammers him.
This is how they do it. 5-on-5, most goals win. All right? Let Sligo first, Joe second, Chris, top corner baby, third, all right, fourth, Lonnie your fifth.
Five round shootout, here we go. The U.S. will start, Sylvester Fliss will give it a crack in this, the first round. Sylvester Fliss, first round, 5 round shootout, gold medal on the line. Here comes Fliss against the Norwegian goaltender, Johansson. Fliss cuts in on goal. Fliss waits, Deeks makes a move, and the save is made by Johansson. A huge save on Sylvester Fliss.
Oh, Johansson getting the blocker out very quickly. That's Sylvester Fliss' best move. He pulled it out, whips his blocker across. Nice save.
Helge Bjørnstad for Norway in the bottom half of the first round. Here comes Bjørnstad. He's got 6 goals in the tournament. Bjørnstad cuts in on Guerra, waits, shoots, scores. Got Guerra to go down and buried it.
Oh, here we see it. Bjørnstad comes down, goes to his right very quickly. Oh, Manny Guerra went for the move.
Joe Howard next up for the U.S. in the second round. Here's Howard trying to pull the U.S. even. They're already in a hole. Howard waits, shoots and scores.
Howard, great play going to this right side. Again, he's doing it for this team.
So the United States even with Norway after a round and a half. And it'll be Peterson to take the shot. Peterson in the second round for Norway, trying to give the lead back to his team. Here's Peterson in on Guerra. Peterson cuts back, shoots, scores. Oh. What a move.
Under the sled, going from right to left. That's a tough one for Guerra to stop.
Norway leading 2-1. Round 3 for the U.S. Chris Manns. The 21-year-old Manns in on Johansson with his left hand. Manns waiting, cutting, shooting and scoring!
Oh, took his time getting there, but he drags it across. Shelf.
Next up for Norway is Roger Hansen against Manny Guerra. Norway 2-for-2 so far in the shootout. Round 3, trying to get the lead back. Here's Hansen in on Guerra, who's well out to challenge. Hansen shot, blocker save made by Guerra.
Guerra understands that he's got to be out a little bit more. An unbelievable job.
Now we are dead even. 4 for the U.S., Kip St. Germain, the veteran, comes out. The former captain, 36 years old. Trying to give the U.S. the lead for the first time in the shootout. St. Germain in on Johansson, who is also out to challenge. St. Germain waiting, shooting, scoring!
Oh, nice and tight. Sends it to the net. This is getting good.
Oh, he's got the crowd going crazy right now. The chance of USA, and now the advantage goes to the U.S. team. keeps Saint Germain, 36 years old, gives the U.S. the lead. Norway will now try to pull even. Svay will work against Guerra. Round four. Here's Svay, hard in on goal. Svay waits, shoots, save made by Guerra.
Matty Guerra playing it well again, coming out and challenging.
The United States has 8,317 people on their feet. If they can score here with Lonnie Hanna, they will win the gold medal. The gold medal is on the line. USA chants ringing through the building. Here comes Hanna for the gold. Hanna waits, waits, shoots, fired it wide. So now the goaltender must make the save, or we're headed to another session and another round of the shootout.
Ian, this does not get any better. First the bronze game, now the gold. What a week.
Haglund for Norway. Round five, the U.S. with the advantage. Guerra needs to make a save, and the gold is for the U.S. Here's Haglund, hit on goal. Haglund shoots, missed the net! The U.S. has won the gold medal!
Well, great. That was good tape.
That was awesome. That was awesome.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
And, I want to thank all you guys for coming tonight.
Thank you for having us.
Really
thank
you.
Thank you. Any exposure we can get, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
I like to extend an invitation to anybody that wants to come out down to the MDC rink on Divine Rink in Dorchester anytime at 9 to 11 on Wednesday night. Feel free, give it a shot. Beginning of the season is the best time to come. We got plenty of sleds to try out, plenty of equipment. You don't know until you try it.
The first time
you won't be as good. You'll get better. Just keep coming.
We expect you to be down there next season, Jeannie.
I'll get myself down there and play around. Okay. Well, thanks a lot.
Thank you.
We're gonna roll the credits and thanks. Super. Good night, everybody, and we hope to see you down in Dorchester.
Thank you.